Welcome to the Garner Church of God. This is Sunday School. Sure do miss all of my classmates, but hope you're having a great week. We have a beautiful day today. Let's get into our lesson. We find ourselves in Daniel, the 8th chapter this week, verses 1 through 27. The title of the lesson is Vision of the Ram and the Goat. And the central truth of the lesson is God has perfect knowledge of future events. So we love to hear good news. The word gospel means good news, and the church should be the bearer of good news to the world. The good news, however, is often prefaced by some bad news. I made a chart here. You can see bad news, good news. Firstly, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Romans 6 and 23. The devil pursues us like a roaring lion, 1 Peter 5 and 8, but James 4 and 7 says we can resist the devil and he will flee. And then we will suffer for Christ, but we will be glorified together with him, Romans 8 and 17. And then in this world we will have tribulation. But Jesus Christ has overcome the world, John 16, 33. So we see the visions of Daniel are good news. However, they contain a lot of troubling information. They tell us that arrogant human rulers will continue to arise and oppose God and his people. And they tell us that persecution is inevitable and believers will sometimes die for their faith. The book of Daniel gives courage and perseverance to God's people who are suffering. The message of Daniel is really, it helps us to endure to the end. We find Matthew 24 and 13. And so if I read that verse, it says, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. And so our study today is meant to give us courage to persevere. Daniel himself was a captive living in a foreign land and was subject to the whims and the wishes of enemy rulers. He was in captivity. Daniel knew God is sovereign and the eternal kingdom of God will eventually be established on earth. Yet the troubles of this present age were so disturbing to Daniel after he saw the vision that he became physically ill. And like Abraham, Daniel was looking for a city whose builder and maker is God, Hebrews 11 and 10. And so in chapter 8, we see a vision given to Daniel to help him to encourage the Jews to remain faithful to God as they lived through the events foretold by the vision. This is for encouragement for us to remain faithful. This lesson can also encourage us to remain faithful to God and to Christ, regardless of the events that we may live through, because we have the assurance God has the perfect knowledge of events before they happen, and he is well able to keep us faithful to him. It says in Isaiah 40 and 31, but they that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. And so this vision in chapter 8 was given to Daniel 2 years after the vision that we studied last Sunday in chapter 7. And it's focused especially on the Persian and the Greek empires in relation to the Jews. Daniel, starting from chapter 2, verse 4 through chapter 7, verse 28, was written in Aramaic, the language of the Babylonians. And from the 8th chapter through the end of the book was written in Hebrew, the visions relating wholly to the Jews and Jerusalem. We know that God made a promise in the covenant he had with Abraham. He said, I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. All people on earth will be blessed through you. And so to me, we find here that from that 8th chapter on, he's writing to his people. The scene narrows from worldwide prophecies to those affecting covenant people, the Jews, or God's people, in the 5 centuries between the exile, which was the captivity, and the advent of the birth of Jesus Christ. And so Daniel wrote about future events because they were disclosed to him by God, and God knows everything about our future. Let's read our scripture in Daniel, the 8th chapter, verses 1 through 3. In the 3rd year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared to me, Daniel, after the one that appeared to me the first time. I saw in the vision, and it so happened while I was looking that I was in Shushan, the citadel, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in the vision that I was by the river Ulai. Then I lifted my eyes and saw, and there, standing beside the river, was a ram which had 2 horns, and the 2 horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher one came up last. In verse 4 through 6, I saw the ram pushing westward, northward, and southward, so that no animal could withstand him, nor was there any that could deliver from his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. And as I was considering, suddenly a male goat came from the west across the surface of the whole earth without touching the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. Then he came to the ram that had 2 horns, which I had seen standing beside the river, and ran at him with furious power. Verses 7 and 8, and I saw him confronting the ram. He was moved with rage against him, attacked the ram, and broke his 2 horns. There was no power in the ram to withstand him, but he cast him down to the ground and trampled him, and there was no one that could deliver the ram from his hand. Therefore, the male goat grew very great, but when he became strong, the long horn was broken. And in place of it, 4 notable ones came up toward the 4 winds of heaven. Verses 9, 13, and 14. And out of one of them came a little horn, which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the glorious land. And then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said to that certain one who was speaking, "How long will the vision be concerning the daily sacrifices and the transgression of desolation, the giving of both the sanctuary and the host to be trampled underfoot?" And he said to me, "For 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed." And so that completes the first section of our 3-section lesson. The first section is Daniel's vision at Susa. And we see firstly the settling of Daniel's vision. Leroy Martin was quoted, "Glory trumps suffering. One morning I woke with severe pains in my abdomen and a very high fever. The pain grew worse and I was taken to the hospital. The doctor said he had bad and good news for me. The bad news was I had appendicitis and must endure surgery. The good news is that I would feel much better in a few days." Paul said to us, "The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Romans 8 and 18. So the setting of Daniel's vision here, Daniel's first message came through a dream, which means that he was asleep during that revelation. However, the second message came by means of vision, which signifies he was awake when the vision appeared before him. Daniel lived in Babylon, but in his vision, he was at the fortress in Shushan, also called Susa. So Shushan was the capital of the province of Elam, 200 miles east of Babylon. A century after the time of Daniel, the Persian king Xerxes built a splendid palace in Shushan, and that is where the events of the book of Esther took place. Also, Nehemiah was King Artaxerxes' cupbearer at that same palace. So Shushan was a well-fortified city. The Hebrew word translated palace means fortress or citadel. And in his vision, Daniel is inside the fortifications. He also saw that he was near the river Ulai, a man-made canal connecting two rivers. So his second revelation appears to be a more detailed look at the third and the fourth kingdoms he saw in that first revelation that we saw recorded in chapter 7. So I put this slide in just so you can get a bit of an idea here that Daniel lives in Babylon up at the top picture, but then below he was bodily in his vision in the city Shushan at the river. Okay? So six major themes are woven throughout chapters 7 through 12. The first one is the height of human pride, especially represented in military power. The second one, an announcement of future deliverance. Thirdly, importance of repentance. Fourthly, spiritual powers that lie behind earthly kingdoms. Fifth, certainty of judgment for all who oppose the will of God. We can be certain of judgment. Sixthly, certainty of God's rule, which includes eternal blessings for God's people. So despite all present indicators to the contrary, God would be victorious in the end. Now, this message was to Daniel, but that message still stays for us today. It stands for us today because we've read the back of the book and we know that we're victorious in the end. And so the second part of section 1, Daniel's vision of the ram in verses 3 and 4. And A.W. Tozer said, we need a baptism of clear seeing. We desperately need seers who can see through the mist. Christian leaders with prophetic vision. And unless they come soon, it'll be too late for this generation. And if they do come, we will no doubt crucify a few of them in the name of our worldly orthodoxy. So let's look at Daniel here in these 3 and 4 verses. While Daniel's dream in chapter 7, he used grotesque animals. The animals in the vision of chapter 8 appear more in a natural form. The first is a ram. As Daniel looked towards the river, he saw a ram with two horns. Now the ram is the leader and the most powerful member of a flock of sheep, and the male goat is the corresponding leader of a flock of goats. And in Daniel's vision, the ram and the male goat represent the power and military might of the kingdoms of Persia and Greece. So the two horns of the ram suggest two kings, two leaders, or two parts of the empire. The two horns represent the Medes and Persians in verse 20. The horns were high, meaning that they were long, but one was longer than the other. The horns did not appear simultaneously, but the longer horn came up last, which represents the Persians who took over the kingdom from the Medes. And so we see here the ram advances in every direction except east. There's no need for him to go east because from the perspective of the Jewish people, the ram is already the ruler of the east. The fact that no beast might stand before him in verse 4 means no other kingdom could resist his military power. So even if kings attempted to make alliances to help each other, their combined powers were not sufficient to prevent the advance of the ram. The expansion of the Persian kingdom eventually made it the greatest on earth back at that time. So then Daniel's vision of the goat in verses 5 through 7. The word considering there in verse 5 means that Daniel was attempting to understand the meaning of what he had just seen, trying to discern the significance of the vision. But while he was thinking on it, he saw a male goat come from the west, and he crossed over the whole earth between west and east. The goat ran so fast that its feet did not touch the ground. In contrast to the ram, which had two horns, the goat had only one horn. However, the single horn was notable, which means that it was very conspicuous, obvious, and large. The horn was between his eyes, which is unusual for a goat. So their horns are normally on top of their head, above the eyes. So as the goat moves towards the east, he approached the ram and ran unto him in the fury of his power. In verse 6, the violence of the attack is emphasized by those three words, ran, fury, and power. He ran rather than marched. His attack was not calm and calculating, but was rather furious or angry. The word power can mean might or strength, but here it means that the goat attacked with great rage. So in verse 7, Daniel repeats that the goat attacked the ram. And the Hebrew words come close means to stretch out or to reach for. The goat attacked the ram with all of his might. And the word caller means bitterness. So the goat struck the ram, shattered both of its horns, and the ram was unable to withstand the force of that goat's attack. The ram was not just defeated, he was thrown to the ground and then trampled by the goat. No other kingdom could give aid to the ram. He was at that point utterly defeated. Well, the goat represents Alexander the Great, who attacked and conquered the Persian Empire during the rule of Darius III. The next portion of our lesson is part D of 1 in verses 8 through 14. And we see here John Calvin said, against the persecution of a tyrant, the godly have no remedy but prayer. And I say prayer is the main thing. Prayer is definitely what we need during times of persecution. So here in verses 8 to 14, the goat became very great, symbolizing that the Greek Empire would be the most extensive empire to have arisen up to that point in history. In verse 8, however, when he was strong or at the height of his power, the great horn was broken. And so it happened with Alexander the Great that he died unexpectedly at the age of 32 after he had extended his kingdom all the way to India. And so the four horns grew up in the place of the one horn as the kingdom was divided into sections. When Alexander died, the Greek Empire was divided between his generals. And so we see here in the picture the four horns. Then the male goat, Alexander, magnified himself exceedingly. But as soon as he was mighty, the large horn was broken. And in its place, there came up four conspicuous horns towards the four winds of heaven. And so here we see what he's talking about. Another picture of it, the great ancestor of the little horn, we see here as true to Daniel's vision. History shows the Grecian Empire, likened to a four-headed leopard with wings, conquered swiftly, and had it not been for Alexander's untimely tragic death, would have continued to conquer. But Daniel then states four others arose in verse 8 to have dominion, and history shows the empire of the great horn Alexander was divided up by four generals, Cassander, Lysicomus, Seleucid, and Ptolemy, I guess, into four provinces, and these being Macedonia, Turkey, Syria, and Egypt. So Daniel then said in verse 9, from one of the four came forth the little horn. And Daniel provided clues, one by defining the timeline conquest by Rome that shows Macedonia as the little horn's ancestor, the very one Rome first conquered to become their final empire. And so we see chapter 8 is unveiled here. The two-horned ram, the horned he-goat, which they said was Alexander the Great, and then out of that, the four new horns, and then the little horn. Very important for us to kind of understand this chapter. This was the best illustration that I could give you. And so, as in chapter 7, Daniel sees the rise of a little horn that grew until it became exceeding great. And that one king expanded toward the south, which is Egypt, the east in Persia, and toward the pleasant land. The pleasant land, which could also be translated beautiful land or glorious land, refers to Judea and the city of Jerusalem. So in verse 10 of the text, the vision becomes more intense and personal for Daniel. The little horn attacks Jerusalem, the holy city. All right, now it's come home to Daniel. Now he sees it hurting something that is so dear to him. And that's the way it is with us. And so it's now bringing it home to him. And it's becoming more personal to Daniel. It is attacking Jerusalem and even brings down some of the host of heaven. Host meaning army. The host of heaven usually refers to the angels of God. And so what's going on? It's beginning to attack the holy city. It's beginning to win against the host or the army of heaven. Again, the illustration here at the bottom is the little horn. And I showed this to one of our young people who's taping me right now last week. And he really got a kick out of this face feature of the little horn. But the little horn, remember, has eyes like the eyes of a man and a mouth speaking great things. And so we see here the host of heaven or the angels of God and Jerusalem. Man, the war, the heat, the pressure, it's coming home to Daniel, and this is not a good feeling. This vision uses symbolism, such as the ram and the goat. Therefore, the host of heaven refers to the Jewish people in Jerusalem who are serving God. By casting down some of the host and of the stars, the little horn is trampling upon the Jewish people. The little horn exalts himself against the prince of the host, who is the high priest in Jerusalem. And through his military might, the little horn forces the priest out of the temple and forbids them from offering sacrifices there. Therefore, the sanctuary was cast down, meaning the temple is desecrated and dishonored. Wow. The high priest, he's winning against that. He forces the priest out of the temple. They can no longer offer their sacrifices. Worship is being desecrated and dishonored. All of the utensils in the temple. A host, an army, is given to the little horn so that he could take control of the daily sacrifice. This was an act of transgression against God. In verse 11, yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away. And the place of his sanctuary was cast down. Furthermore, the little horn will cast down the truth. For the Jews, the truth is found in the Torah, or the law of Moses. And as we mentioned in the previous lesson in chapter 7, Antiochus forbade Jewish religious practice and required everyone to worship the Greek god Zeus. The fact that it practiced and prospered means the little horn succeeds in performing his will. One of the things that we see there, Antiochus forbade Jewish religious practice. They all were to worship the god Zeus. This means that some of the Jewish community must have gone along with the requirement. But there was a remnant. There were those that remained steadfast before the Lord. And so the scene changes when Daniel hears one of the saints, a believing Jew, ask, "How long will the vision be?" They are not asking about the duration of the visionary experience, but the duration of the actions that are being foretold in the vision. In other words, they're saying, how long will this desecration last? And I believe as a people of God, we must ask ourselves, how long will He hold back His wrath? How long will we see the desecration or the sin in this world that you and I live in? When we look at the fact that they have made it legal, abortion, to kill babies right on up to, you know, birth, and the things that they are allowing, our hearts cry out, how long will this desecration last? It touches us, His people. Now they're messing with Daniel's Jerusalem, and they're messing with God's people. Amen. They ask about the absence of the daily sacrifice and about the transgression of desolation, which refers to Antiochus's building of an altar to Zeus in the Jerusalem temple and offering a pig on the altar. This was total desecration of that was sanctified and holy unto God. In fact, he had his army sacrifice a pig in the holiest part of the Jewish temple. Wow. At the same time, the host or the people of God are being trampled underfoot, powerless against the military might of this little horn. The answer comes to Daniel that the sanctuary will be cleansed after 2,300 days or 6.3 years in verse 14. And then let's look at verse 15 through 17. Then it happened when I, Daniel, had seen the vision and was seeking the meaning, that suddenly there stood before me one having the appearance of a man. And I heard a man's voice between the banks of the Ulai, who called and said, Gabriel, make this man understand the vision. So he came near where I stood, and when he came, I was afraid and fell on my face. But he said to me, understand, son of man, that the vision refers to the time of the end. And verse 18 and 19, now as he was speaking to me, I was in a deep sleep with my face to the ground. But he touched me and stood me upright and said, look, I am making known to you what shall happen in the latter time of the indignation. For at the appointed time, the end shall be. So let's look at our second section of the lesson. God provides an interpreter. We see the appearance of Gabriel in verses 15 and 16. After the vision ended, Daniel sought for the meaning seeking the face of God. And therefore, Daniel's response to the vision, he began to seek God's face. He began to pray, to ask, and to wait on God for the interpretation. He doesn't reveal how long he sought God, but at some point, a messenger of God appeared to Daniel in human form. And Daniel then heard a man's voice coming from between the banks of the river. It was either the voice of God or the voice of an angel, but calling it a man's voice means that Daniel was able to understand what was being spoken at that time. So the voice said in human language, Gabriel, make this man to understand the vision. This is the first of four mentions of the angel Gabriel in Scripture. Daniel was unable to discern the interpretation of the vision, but Gabriel was sent to provide it. This is a reminder to Christians that God is not silent. He speaks to His people today, most often and especially through His written word, the Bible, and by the Holy Spirit in conjunction with His word. But still, God can speak to His people through dreams, visions, and even by an angel if He chooses to do so. However God may choose to speak to us, it is so that we may know His nature and His will, and also that His good will may be accomplished in our lives. And so, as Daniel did, we see here that he stood before the Lord to understand the vision. He began to seek the Lord's face. This is a reminder to us that we seek the Lord. We go to the Word of God and we ask Him for His meaning and His interpretation. And He will make Himself known to us during those times. We see here the time of the end in verses 17 through 19. Although Gabriel had the appearance of a man, Daniel knew he was a messenger of God, and therefore he was afraid. And out of deep reverence and respect, Daniel fell on his face before Gabriel. The messenger informed Daniel that the vision was a description of the time of the end. And whenever we hear the end, we think of the end of the world and the end of this age. In the Old Testament, however, the end can refer to the end of a certain period of time, such as the end of the Old Covenant and beginning of the Messianic Age, that is, the coming of Jesus, the Messiah. And so obviously not all of Daniel's vision refers to the end of time. The interpretation specifically names the kingdoms of Persia and Greece, two kingdoms that were prominent before the end of the Old Testament times, but they soon faded. They did not persist as empires until the end of the world. So as mentioned in the previous lesson, most interpreters believe one of two views of Daniel's vision. Either they were fulfilled in history, or they are yet to be fulfilled in the last days, leading to the second advent of Jesus. Perhaps both are true. Some elements of Daniel's prophecies were literally fulfilled during the intertestamental period. So the Persian Empire arose and fell, and so did the Greek Empire. An evil general named Antiochus IV Epiphanes attacked the Jews and defiled the temple in Jerusalem, but God gave the Jews victory and restored the temple to its rightful place. These fulfillments only partially complete the vision in Daniel's dreams and vision. Go back up there and look at that. They had defiled the temple in Jerusalem, but God gave the Jews victory and restored the temple worship to them. These visions are symbolic, prophetic, and represent a repetition of evil throughout history. The abomination of desolation was first committed by Antiochus and was repeated in AD 70 by the Romans when they invaded Jerusalem. These acts, however, are prophetic of the last days, when the same desecration will be committed before the return of Jesus. Old Testament prophecies often combine both short-term and long-term predictions in a way that we find difficult to separate. And like Daniel, we too must seek after God for the interpretation, and we must hold the mystery until the time comes that its meaning is fully revealed. And in verse 18 tells us the appearance of Gabriel was so powerful that Daniel became unconscious. But Gabriel reached out and touched Daniel and caused him to stand upright. And Gabriel adds two important comments here. First, the vision regards the last end of the indignation in verse 19. Which means the time when God in His anger will punish human beings for their sins. And this will be followed by the restoration of the people of God, who will be reconciled with their Creator and Master after having received their own chastisement. And secondly, the end cannot be hastened and it cannot be delayed. Its time is appointed by God Himself. The end will come when God says, "It's the end." Now, God was angry with the Jews for their sinfulness, and so for an appointed time, the Jews would suffer under God's corrective discipline until all that God intended this to accomplish for them was at an end. That's the reason they went into exile. God, by his sovereign power and authority over all things, would accomplish this for the Jews, even as he guided the course of the world's kingdoms. In fact, unknown to the rulers of ancient empires, their very existence was part of God's plan to bring Jesus, the Messiah Savior, into the world via the nation of Israel, the Jews. Daniel, he was afraid and he fell face down when Gabriel approached or appeared and spoke to him. So how do you think you would respond or react if an angel of God appeared and spoke to you? What would you do? Have you ever felt the need to fall down before God in reverent worship of him, so overcome with his love and his grace and his mercy and his blessings that you literally had no interest whatsoever in anything else but just worshiping him? Why did you respond this way to God? And what brought about this kind of response? It just brings us to the idea here that we need to be worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because he is sovereign and he is in charge of everything that's going on in our lives. We may feel that we're in exile, that maybe we're going through a dark time or a difficult period, but God is in control, and we just need to fall before him and worship him in the very beauty of holiness. Let's look at the third section and last one. Daniel, the 8th chapter, verse 20 through 22 says, "The ram which you saw having the two horns, they are the kings of Media and Persia. And the male goat is the kingdom of Greece. The large horn that is between its eyes is the first king. As for the broken horn and the four that stood up in its place, four kingdoms shall arise out of that nation, but not without its power. And in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their fullness, a king shall arise, having fierce features, who understands sinister schemes. His power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. He shall destroy fearfully and shall prosper and thrive. He shall destroy the mighty and also the holy people. Through his cunning, he shall cause deceit to prosper under his rule, and he shall exalt himself in his heart. He shall destroy many in their prosperity. He shall even rise against the prince of princes, but he shall be broken without human means." And so in the third section, we find Gabriel's interpretation. In verses 20 to 22, we see Media, Persia, and Greece. And so we've already discussed the historical meaning of the ram and the goat. The two-horned ram represents the kings of the Medo-Persian Empire. And the goat is the Greek Empire, and its horn is Alexander the Great, who conquered the Persians in 330 BC. Now, after Alexander's death, his kingdom was divided, but none of the succeeding kings rose to the level of Alexander's power. We find here in the section B, the persecution of God's people in verses 23 to 25. Near the end of the Greek period, Antiochus the IV Epiphanes would rise to power. The description of him as understanding dark sentences in verse 23 implies what we might call an evil genius. Antiochus was intelligent, skilled in intrigue, and characterized by duplicity. He was a ruthless, malicious, spiteful leader who showed pity to no one. Antiochus became powerful. However, his power was not his own. It was given to him by Almighty God, and it would be taken away by God. He would decimate the holy people, which was fulfilled when Antiochus killed 80,000 Jews in 168 BC. Now look at Antiochus here in the little chart to the right, not sure if you can see it, but outlawed Judaism, looted the temple. He built Acre, a Greek citadel city, to control Jerusalem. He persecuted the Jews, and there was an abomination of desolation. further descriptions of Antiochus, which also described the beast of the last days, follows. He would cause craft to prosper. The word craft means deceit. Thus, the meaning is that he would make treachery succeed. Secondly, he would magnify himself, meaning that he would grow arrogantly. Thirdly, he, by peace, shall destroy many. And the words by peace refer to the fact that the Jews thought themselves to be living in safety and peace, that Antiochus would attack them without warning, just when they thought they were safe. Fourthly, he would stand up against the prince of princes. In Hebrew, the word prince does not mean the son of the king. It is another word for the king himself. Therefore, the prince of princes refers to God. So he would stand up against God. Antiochus, fifthly, would be broken without hand, which means God would destroy him without using human means. Antiochus died insane in Persia in 163 BC. And then section C of the third part, Daniel's illness. Daniel is told the vision is true and that he should seal it up for now, but not forever. The experience so overwhelmed Daniel, he fainted, and he remained ill for a number of days. You see, Daniel was deeply concerned. The Jews, he knew from this, would suffer terrible persecution for their faith in the Lord. What's our response to persecution? You know, you think about Daniel overcome there. He fainted. He was stood up on his feet. But look at the overwhelming feeling, how he connected to this vision. Because this vision applies to the future, Daniel could not fully understand it, and neither can we. We see here verses 26 and 27, the vision of the evening and the morning which was told is true. Wherefore shut thou up the vision. And Daniel fainted, and he was sick. But we look here, now as the angel explains to him about long periods of time, talks about many days, Daniel is shocked and afraid that maybe the Jews would not be returning home after all. It bothered him so much that he fainted. He was horrified at what he had seen about the terrible little horn power and what it would do to the dear children of God. In other words, he went into mourning. It's hard to have hope when he looked at that example or that vision of what God had shown him. And so it was hard to have hope. But stick with it here. Daniel's second revelation reminds us again that evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. In 2 Timothy 3:13, we are blessed to be living in the age of the Spirit when God has given us the comfort and the strength of His presence. And so finally, in conclusion, we see wars and rumors of wars. We see famines, pestilence, floods, and earthquakes. But we know that God will make all things new in the end. Therefore, we live in hope of a new heaven and a new earth. In 2 Peter 3:13, this sinful world will be destroyed. Nevertheless, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. And so, saint of God, I try to encourage you this morning. Don't lose hope. Keep your head up. Redemption draweth nigh. And I failed to open up with prayer. I want to end with prayer because we have a lot of prayer requests that we've been praying over for several weeks now. And let's go to the Lord in prayer. God is our answer. He is our strength. He is our help. And He sends His Holy Spirit. So be encouraged. We've looked in the back of the book, and it turns out real good for the saints of God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank You for Your presence. We thank You for Your word. We thank You for Your Holy Spirit. We ask You now, Lord, to go out and to touch those that have listened to this message today. God, we know, Lord, that You're able to take Your word and use it, Lord Jesus, to open up our hearts and our minds that we might reflect Your glory, that we might look more like You, Lord Jesus. us than we ever have before. These are your last days, and we pray that we're about the Father's business, doing that we're called to do, and we ask it in your righteous and holy name. Amen.